Ladies and gentlemen, you've already been welcomed by Andrew, notwithstanding the fact that he seems to be drowning in a sea of advice. But I feel as patron I ought to offer you a formal welcome, and I take great pleasure in doing so. As always, the conference is very well attended. In all, we have about 1,400 people present at this year's conference, and I'm told that that is the largest attendance we have had at a national conference in Brisbane. I am sure that the many sessions listed in the program offer a wide array of entertaining and experienced commentators on a broad range of topics of current interest. And after Andrea addresses you following my remarks, there will be a Q&A session, not conducted by Tony Jones, between Andrea and the Assistant Treasurer. As most of you know, I am and have been a lawyer. I first began to study law in 1946, some improbable 68 years ago. As I look back now on the law as it was then, shortly after World War II, I can see how much it has changed in the intervening years. But generally speaking, subject to some qualifications, the change has been incremental and evolutionary rather than radical. Superannuation seems to be something of an exception to that generalisation. With superannuation, change often seems to be the order of the day, as governments think of new ways in which they can access or make use of superannuation funds, whether by way of tax changes or use for favoured projects such as infrastructure. In addition, governments have different perspectives on how the financial services industry should be regulated. These developments can compromise not only stability, which is an essential element in a well-functioning financial services industry, but also the confidence of investors, particularly those who invest in and rely on superannuation. Last Monday's newspapers carried reports that a number of the financial services reforms planned by the previous federal government will be wound back. Among the reforms to be wound back, according to one report, was the best interest duty. The Australian went further and reported that the well-known law firm Arnold Bloch Leibler, which acts for industry super, has predicted that if a class action is commenced, the court will declare the new regime invalid in the event that the federal government goes ahead with plans to implement changes by regulation rather than legislation. It is not for me to comment on the advice given by Arnold Bloch Leibler, but there are some points I want to make, and I want to make them as forcefully as I can. First, if it should come about that some aspect of the best interest duty, say the catch-all provision, is to be wound back, it would be a serious mistake to think that a financial advisor is under no duty to act in the interests of the client. Quite apart from other relevant statutory provisions, the common law recognises a duty on an advisor to act in the interests of its client. True it is that the provisions of the contract between advisor and client can regulate the rights and duties of the parties to the contract, and at least to some extent, the provisions can exclude or limit the advisor's liability. But it would be unsafe to assume that cleverly worded contractual terms will always protect the financial advisor who is acting in his own interests rather than the interests of the client. And there is a case for saying that people entering into contracts with financial advisors should be warned or advised as to the existence and consequences of provisions excluding or limiting liability on the part of the advisor, or which have that effect by limiting the scope of the instructions given to the advisor. It is the use, or perhaps even the abuse, of such provisions that may give rise to problems in the future. My second point follows on from the first. It is to the advantage to all the stakeholders in the financial services industry that their action should be directed to promoting confidence in the industry. And that calls for fair and open dealing in an industry whose principal purpose, as its name implies, is to provide services rather than to sell products. Advisors are professionals. Salesmen, no matter how successful they may be, are not professionals. More than anything else, an emphasis on high standards of professionalism is likely to generate confidence in the financial services industry, and in particular, in superannuation. I want to turn to another subject. Formerly SMSFs, fortunately, SMSFs have become the subject of expert research and analysis. Only this month, the Federal Parliamentary Library published its history of major superannuation and retirement income changes in Australia. Adrian Raftery, a PhD student at UTS, has published his 401-page thesis entitled "The Size, Cost, Asset Allocation and Audit Attributes of Australian SMSFs." The author finds that SMSFs enjoy economies of scale in relation to running costs, with the annual median cost being half of those of industry and retail funds. The author concludes that the relatively low cost structure of SMSFs may have a positive impact on the final retirement balance for a model portfolio when compared with the fees of the two other types of superannuation funds. The author also finds evidence of fee discounting by the leading providers of SMSF audits. Josephine Castillo, another PhD student, has completed a thesis at the University of Tasmania on the regulation of SMSFs in Australia. The thesis examines the regulation of the sector by the ATO and other agencies and concludes that the regime appears to be performing very well in enhancing members' retirement savings. In a few years, the number of SMSF members in Australia will reach 1 million. The thesis raises the question whether the correct agencies are regulating SMSFs and whether they do so in a coordinated fashion without duplication. The thesis also indicates there has been a significant reduction in contraventions from 11% in 2008 to 7.2% in 2009 and only 1.9% in 2010 and 2011. As Jeremy Cooper said at this conference in 2010, on the whole, the statistics show the SMSF sector is in pretty good shape. The thesis concludes with some useful recommendations for improvement of the regulatory regime. SPAR has vigorously encouraged research into the sector because it believes that effective policy decisions affecting the sector must be based on a clear and detailed understanding of the sector and what it is doing. At the same time, SPAR has also vigorously encouraged the rise of a system of SMSF professionals, professionals who are dedicated and committed to providing advice to stakeholders in the sector. SPAR believes that it is simply not good enough to rely on those persons, whether professionals or not, whose commitment to the sector is secondary to other concerns and activities. Neither superannuation nor the SMSF sector is immune from change. But there are some things that should remain constant. One is that superannuation is about saving for the future. It is not about risk-taking. Another is that the future of the financial services industry lies in the provision of quality advice and high professional standards, not in the selling of products. And the third is that the stakeholders in the industry should do everything that they can to promote confidence in the industry. I conclude my remarks by saying that I hope you all find the conference instructive and enjoyable.